All right.
Okay.
Hi, everyone.
Well, just to introduce our very own Professor Carl Smith, who's Associate Professor of Media at the University of East London. Take it away, Carl.
Cheers. Okay, so today I'm going to talk about holotechnica, exploring the nexus of altered states and altered traits. So the content for the short talk today, so defining it, talking about the traditional psychedelics, plant medicine, entheogens, then the cyberdelics, then endotechnologies, and then stacks between these three classes. And I'm going to talk about the book that I'm writing and some conclusions. So this talk I've been giving since the pandemic in different iterations, really building on it each time. This was at UCL. This was also at Cambridge, and this one at the York University, and more recently at Oxford. So I've really sort of been asking the community, what are the ultimate stacks to achieve altered traits, not just altered states, which you could argue are very much sort of kind of gimmicky, not very long lasting. How do we create long lasting change with the ultimate protocols? So the definition, holotechnica, holo to combine into the whole, technica, techniques. And yeah, so what are these different techniques? And what I'm doing is creating a database of these consciousness expanding techniques, presentations, and it is all about dialogos. The evolution of humanity is related to the growth and expansion of consciousness. Absolutely agree with them there. So I'm not going to go into too much detail on some of these. You can read the slides later on, but you know, we've got a lot of different traditional medicines out there, and we know about the commercialization of psychedelics. It is a psychedelic renaissance that we're seeing. And cyberdelics, I'm much more interested in non-drug altered states and altered traits, primarily because they are more democratic. I think a lot of the substances are still going to be illegal around the world, even though we're seeing legalization. But people just are too scared as well of taking psychedelics because a lot of people don't like the lack of control. Whereas if you put on a psychedelic, at least you can switch it off. You're not enjoying it anymore. And then we've got all the endotechnology. So these are experiences that we can have without any external stimuli. There's a lot of lists. I'm going to go through some of the examples here. So how do these ingredients affect each other in the stacks as well? So we're going to have three different stacks, and then we're going to talk about how we combine those different stacks. So one of the big definitions is this idea from Bohm here, this idea of dialogue. I really think the magic happens when we start to combine things. A lot of my friends that are quite dubious about a lot of this research is that we don't really understand consciousness. I'd always laugh about the transhumanists who say that we can upload consciousness, but we don't know what consciousness is. So good luck with that. And my colleague here, Matthew Clark, he's done a lot of research in India, specifically in India, to understand this magical elixir of soma. And soma we don't really know much about, but according to his research, soma included up to 100 different ingredients. And depending on where you were in India, it would be a completely different recipe. So these are some typical altered states. We all experience them. These are transitory. You know, when we go to sleep every night, it's a form of an altered state. If you lucid dream, it's again a very different kind of altered state, but it's something that you can practice. It's something that you can control. How many of you have had a lucid dream? So quite a few of you. How many of you have had multiple lucid dreams? Excellent. Can keep up the good work. So altered traits. This is a great book on that subject. An altered trait is a lasting change, and one of the best bits of research is really on meditators and lasting changes that meditators have made to their brains. So there is hard evidence that these things do have lasting neurological and biological changes. So the definition here is like, how do we bring things back from these experiences? A lot of people are just chasing their tails. They're just constantly trying to reach a peak experience and then go back in and not really integrate in this kind of epiphany porn scenario. So I believe we're now, the technologies that we're able to access and the research that we're doing at Imperial really allows us to understand that we can enter this new frontier of paralleling consciousness. and stretching out the human experience. Not just the human experience. So, you know, this is a form of stacking in another sense. We can learn a lot from the other kingdoms. So let's look at some of the psychedelics. There's lots of research going on now where we're seeing combinations in clinical terms here, combining MDMA and LSD. And there's all sorts of combinations. These are some of the most hilarious. But yeah, like I say, look at this in more detail in the recording. A god flip sounds interesting. I've done some psilocybin. Psilocybin is legal in Amsterdam. A lot of this stuff is still legal in Amsterdam, even though we've got the far right government coming in and trying to remove those privileges. But psilocybin is when you combine mushrooms with Syrian rue. And it's, I can tell you, quite something. It's an alien invasion every time. I recommend it for everyone. This is me at Imperial College London before being injected with DMT and having my brain scanned. This is me directly afterwards. So it is it's an extraordinary substance that is natural to our brains. It's in almost every plant. So it's something that we really are yet to fully understand. It is basically very similar to serotonin. It is a neurotransmitter, so again, hilarious that it's a class A drug. We also know now that if you're to give somebody DMT in an ambulance whilst they're having a heart attack, they're more likely to survive the journey to get to the hospital. So if you're having a stroke or a heart attack, this is extremely important medicine and research that's happening. One of the big projects that I'm involved with over in California now, off the back of doing 8 years research as a participant at Imperial, is a project with New Nautics where we have a legal license to give people DMT extended stay experiences. So we're targeting scientists, mathematicians, indigenous leaders. All of you are welcome, of course. But what's the difference between doing DMT in a hospital wing of Imperial versus a Caribbean island in a five-star resort? I think this is where we'll start to get some seriously decent results, because obviously everything is about context. So some of the key questions here is that can extending the state of DMT, so the research here is much like when you're being anesthetized, you are continuously infused with that anesthetic to make sure that you stay asleep during your, or stay knocked out rather, during your operation. So we use the same technology to continuously feed DMT into the system and keep you at the peak of the experience, potentially indefinitely. Again, I'm erring on the side of caution. I think we're here to have a human experience, not to have a DMT experience, you know, to live in hyperspace, which is what Andrew Gallimore, my colleague, wants to do. So what's really fascinating about this is this idea of a curated trip. So say you're inside the experience, you're still fully conscious in terms of your ego is still very present. And say you have come across some entities in the journey and you suddenly think, ooh, I'd like to increase the resolution of this experience. So can you increase the dose so that I can have this meeting with these entities and then you can turn the dose down? So it's this curatable trip, which I find specifically interesting. And then we're also looking at how do we combine different substances together to make sure, because I was the only person to really go through all five experiences. I was subject zero. And I got through I was the first person to do all five dosing days at Imperial. And it's not for the faint-hearted, as I mentioned. So if we can combine with some sort of medicine to calm you down during that experience, I think there's something to be said for it. What I'd love to do, though, is to have a long enough experience where I can fall asleep inside the DMT experience and have the DMT dream. So let's move on to psychedelics. So we all know that media itself is becoming very deep fakeable. Everything's becoming fakeable. You know, it's a fascinating time that apparently a lot of AI models are not being released until after this year, because we know how dangerous a lot of this stuff can be during election years. It's an interesting time to be a professor of media when media itself is becoming real. So I formed the Psychedelic Society with my colleagues back in 2015, and I think that, like I said, there's a big demand for these different technologies. If you think about a psychedelic, psychedelic experiences happen because of something changing within, or technodelic or cyberdelic experiences happen because of something changing externally. And this is the work of my friend Jose, the co-founder of Cyberdelic Society, which is again another stack. His idea of virtuality stack. So cyberdelics combined with sensory theatre, combined with context engineering and ritual technologies, create something quite extraordinary. And I think even though we're still seeing, we're still waiting for VR to really hit the mainstream, maybe it never will, maybe it will always remain niche. I still think we're not just classing cyberdelics as, you know, as purely VR, we're also including flicker machines, sound as cyberdelic. Anything that's electronic can be classed as a cyberdelic, and I think it's only when you start to combine these things that you really get somewhere. And in fact, one of the speakers, Gavin here, he runs the Roxiva company with Jimmy, and he creates extraordinary DMT-like experiences inside the Flickr machine. So this is a modern-day version of the Dream Machine from Tyson. But he makes sound to go with it, which is completely synced, so it's extraordinary. And I always want to mention David Glowacki's work, Business, where you would don these VR headsets, but the VR system is linked up to a very heavyweight physics machine, and you were able to literally see yourself as light, extremely psychedelic. So there's all sorts of different retreats, psychedelic coaching, meditation apps, neuro wearables, neuro spas, different apps, different platforms, different ways of having cymatics in terms of the somatic versions. Sound Self, for instance, is a bed that you lie in, but it's your voice that drives the experience. And you're literally laying in the field of your own voice, which is extraordinarily psychedelic. So going back to basics, what are the endotechnologies? So remember, endotechnologies are things that you can do by yourself without any external stimuli. If you haven't seen the work of John Vivekey, that's an extraordinary resource. Where he talks a lot. He's got a 50 series YouTube experience that you can check out. One of the things I did first of all at Imperial was get paid to take LSD in hospital and just work, just do my normal work. I was like, finally, you know, finally the circle has been complete. So getting paid to just sit and work. But what was extraordinary was that the LSD was nowhere near as powerful as the breathwork. The breathwork was the control. So we had a breathwork facilitator come in and gave me an hour-long breathwork session with music. And that really did blow my mind with the LSD, which was just like in the office. So we also know many different types of meditation. I've done the Finders course where they've taken 1,000 different types of meditation and get those down to around 24 different types, which you try over a 17-week period. So every 3 days, you'll do a different type of meditation. And again, you're stacking these different meditations. You're in a buddy group, and you find out what's the best protocol for you, what meditations work. That course doesn't exist anymore, but there is a 45-day version that I have. And then dance, you know, there's the five rhythms. I don't know how many of you have tried five rhythms, but there's many different types of dance that, again, they're stacking. It's all different leagues. And if you're fasting before doing some of these experiences, then fasting at the base level is going to change all of the things above it in that stack. Also, darkness is an extraordinary protocol. If you go into the darkness for 5 to 17 days, you can have an extraordinary psychedelic trip without any psychedelics. It's very common now to do cold and water immersion. I had an extraordinary non-drug experience when I was up at Kaimabon doing breath work in combination with cold immersion, and experienced the flower of life just appear in the sky for a long period of time. This is me with Wim Hof. This is something we do every year, is go to the Giza and hire the Great Pyramid every year. This will be the fourth year where we've done it. And
so this is a measurement of Carl's brain waves, and as you can see, his delta is way higher than anything else, suggesting that he should be asleep. Gamma very, very
low. So what you're seeing there is Kaz, who's also going to be speaking in the research workshop. She snuck in an EEG device and measured all of our brainwaves while I was completely sober inside the King's Chamber of the Great Pyramid. And it looked like we were all asleep according to our brainwaves. So how the architecture is putting us into this liminal deep state, anyone's guess. I'd love to know more about that. So to finish, how do we stack between these stacks? There's something called moist media, where we are seeing people combine different substances with different technologies, mostly VR. A great Reddit group called Ripped Into the Mind, you should check out on that regard. So moist media is actually, combining dryware with wetware. And you can see here people who have been severely burnt in the military using virtual reality in combination with ketamine to help them change their dressings. And Jamie Will talks about this idea again in his work, Flow Genome Project. Hedonic engineering, these different stacks to reach specific altered states. I think altered traits is where it's at. And one of the things that I'm really interested in is combining the lineages of ancient Egypt and India with South America. So this is a group that created these elixirs. So it's combining things like saffron. So saffron is an extraordinary stimulant. It's the most expensive spice, but it also acts like an MDMA alternative. And frankincense is an alternative to Valium. So, different lineages have the same solutions that we have in the West, but maybe in a much healthier way. So combining these medicines with the DMT journeys is, again, an extraordinary idea. So another stack here, combining and taking psychedelics with, so I would love to do DMT on a roller coaster, for instance. And, it's not yet to be done, but I think this has to be done. And in terms of dream hacking, we all, we talked about lucid dreaming. This is kind of the Persinger version. This is the old school. This is the new. So this is a device called the Halo, which is about to be released. It's a transcranial stimulation. But what it does is it reliably, supposedly, creates lucid dreams on demand. So this is very transhumanist, in my opinion. It's like, all that work that you've done to get to lucid dreaming yourselves. take away the need, but then you may never be able to have a lucid dream by doing the work. Just outsource it to the technology like we're seeing wholesale with AI. But lots of things that you can do. I mean, one of the things that worries me about this new reality of lucid dreams on demand is that we'll probably spend our time working in those lucid dreams. That'll be probably the only space left to do all the things that we haven't managed to do. We now see that there's research so we can control our smart devices from our lucid dreams. I'm not advocating any of this stuff, I'm just warning you. Lots of people are doing yoga nidra, which is this idea of learning vocabulary, learning new languages as you fall asleep, playing tapes, actually learning these things. Your metaprogramming, it's a liminal state. From the experience just doing breath work and standing on one of these, a Shakti mat, which is the modern day version of a bed of nails. Highly recommend it. If you haven't got a Shakti mat and you've got back pain, then you know what to do. So just to finish, I'm writing this book on Holotechnica. We've started doing interviews with some key practitioners. This is Sarah, who's fusing psychedelics with VR and art. Gavin, I've already talked about, he's going to give his talk on his stack. And Kaz as well. She's done something called loop busting, which is an extraordinary technique. She managed to get rid of her bipolar disorder just through DMT. So extraordinary what these medicines can achieve, as long as you're doing the work as well. I don't think there are such things as magic bullets. I think that a lot of the time you have to combine these things as tools with a lot of intention. Preparation. So for me, it's all about context engineering. What I'm trying to do in the Caribbean project is, as head of context engineering, is really create the perfect parasympathetic nervous system going into such experiences, whether it's a lomi-lomi massage where you're having five people massage you at the same time. Imagine 10 hands. You're like floating in the air at some point in this sort of suspended animation. So yeah, so consciousness is programmable, but what can we do with it? What can we do with more neuroplasticity? Neuroplasticity for what end?
Consciousness.
And last slot, this idea around, here a great quote about Buddhism and virtual reality, bringing up this idea of dependency on the technology, and also making the point that maybe we were dependent on things like Buddhism, or are dependent on it. Any structure used to access the divine can become a crutch if not designed and skilled and used skillfully. If people think they can slip on a piece of technology and break through to an awareness of God, how on earth can we be expected to do the deep work needed to transform our predicament? There appears to be an insatiable desire to keep on improving and innovating on things that are fine as they are, and it's distracting us from the real problems. The irony of it all is that all that we need to really do is simply stop. Buddhism or any other wisdom tradition doesn't need the allure of technology to be accessible. Our constant obsession with hacking consciousness with technology is driving us further away. We are consciousness, and our collective shadow deepens when we run the idea that we can just hack away at ourselves to reveal our true purpose. It shows how insecure and neurotic our collective identity is. So I always like to count everything I'm saying, test everything I'm doing, stress test everything I'm doing. Some new books out there, my DMT experiences are captured here in this new book on DMT entities. This book is also just released. I've got a chapter in there. Thank you very much.
John. Right, we've got time for one question. A very quick observation from yours truly. I've not done psychedelics myself, partly because I have very vivid dreams. I have tried the Monroe Institute. been very effective. Quick thought here is that all these experiences are subjective and internal. They're not something that you can actually easily project to the outside. But there are some early indications of a technology that may use AI to actually interpret some of the sort of the brainwave states and actually build some kind of imagery around us. I mean, what are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, it's a great point. And again, dream recording may well be possible because of that as well. But the problem with psychedelic journeying is it may not originate in the visual cortex. We've seen, you know, evidence from people that are blind, that are still experiencing trips, visuals, but not, you know, not dream visuals. People that don't have any visual imagery still experiencing that. So it's all to play for. But yeah, thanks for the question, Nick.
Any other questions? Yes, indeed. Sorry.
Thanks, Carl. I want you to go even further. You probably feel that you've gone almost full distance. But for instance, I want to tie two things together. We all know, and we possibly read in the paper recently, for the last 5 days, we've reached 1.5 degrees above pre-industrial temperature levels. And that was the level that we were aiming to get to in 2050, but we've already got there. So the big question is, going into the future, and is there going to be a planet left that we can live in and so on, is the answer in somewhere in the, I don't know how to explain it, but all the points you were making, which affect us and the way we want to live, and therefore the effect we have on the planet, is the answer there much more than it is concentrating on reducing fossil fuels, just to give one example.
Wow, that's a small question. I mean, I think the key thing is that we need to have the experience of living inside a nested ecology. You know, if we can have that felt experience, if we can care more for what we're doing with our resources, you know, choosing not to replace your mobile phone when you've smashed the screen, but just finding an alternative to how you use it. So for instance, I plug a mouse into my phone and trying to then create a behavior around that so other people start adopting that. So being more responsible with our technology use. I mean, I've given you a whole selection of different protocols there. So maybe not doing the ones that are heavy on the electricity, but more on the things that you can do for yourself to have that kind of experience of feeling alive in this jackpot experience, which is what it is to be human for this very brief period, but also thinking intergenerationally and thinking about the five generations beyond us, intergenerational projects that we have. We don't just think about our own selves and our own projects, but what can we lead? What, cathedral consciousness, I think, is what I'm talking about. How do we build things for the future that aren't just going to be within our lifespans?
Well, thank you very much.